It's very nice to be with the Q-Chem family here. I've been a user of Q-Chem for at least 8 years or so, and I really enjoy having my group being part of the Q-Chem family. So I'm just going to really begin by telling you some of the things that my research group is involved with. We have a set of interests that actually, as Emil was saying, are at the interface between quantum information and chemistry, broadly defined. So one of our research areas is, for example, how to make quantum chemistry using quantum computers rather than regular classical computers. And so we have developed algorithms to solve the electronic structure problem. So how molecules, electronic structure of molecules and how they behave exactly using quantum computers. And it has also, this has also been realized experimentally, for example, in quantum optics with collaborators. We like to develop electronic structure methods, and many of these implementations are in Q-Chem, either in the public version or in our private versions, soon to be public. In particular, we have been very interested in the actual behavior of molecules in strongly dissipative environments, and we have developed theories such as, for example, density functional theory for open quantum systems. We're also interested in the concept of organic photovoltaics, solvents that's made of plastic. That's maybe the subject of this talk today. And I'm also very interested in the field of so-called excitonics, or how electronic energy is transferred, for example, in photosynthesis. So anyway, this is an overview of the areas that my group is actually pursuing. And today, again, we'll talk about organic photovoltaics. So I'd like to start with the idea of an organic photovoltaic material as a flexible substrate coated with a plastic. It could be a set of molecules, or it could be a polymer that absorbs sunlight. For example, we see here on the right one of the panels manufactured by the company called Konarka, former company called Konarka. And you can actually see that, you know, very little amount of material can be spread over a flexible substrate. And then you can have a solar cell that, for example, in the particular case of this woman here on the left, will charge her iPhone, which is a very important function in the modern world. So they, of course, hold promise for having flexible coatings and making active surfaces that actually can harvest sunlight. So why would a junior faculty member think about organic solar cells? Well, if you want to think about organic solar cells, you can actually start comparing the different types of solar cells. Okay, for example, you can have the most efficient solar cells that I'm going to be highlighting over here, right? They're multi-junction, multi-crystalline solar cells that actually are used only in satellites because they are so expensive, right? On the other hand, the solar cells that are installed in your rooftop are about 12% efficient or so, and you can actually see that since the 90s, not too much action has been happening in making them more efficient. It's mostly making them cheaper. On the other hand, these organic solar cells made of plastic, when I started working on them, they were about 3 or 4% efficient. I was started working on them in 2006, and many groups around the world have taken them all the way down to around 10 to 11% in the time scale I have been a professor here at Harvard. So it's quite exciting to actually be working in a technology that, due to advances in the basic science and the advances in technology, is actually starting to compete in terms of efficiency with the solar cells made of traditional materials. So that's exciting, and you can actually see all the different company names or universities and different efficiencies of these emerging organic solar cells. This is a chart by the Department of Energy, by the way. Okay, so how do organic photovoltaics work? You have the formation of an electron hole pair or exciton in a donor material. In this particular case, I'm showing it through a molecular crystal, for example, pentazine, but you can imagine also polymer, as I'll show you in the next animation. This electron hole pair migrates to an interface where it dissociates into an electron that stays, say, in the acceptor layer and moves, the hole moves through the donor layer towards the anode. And when the electron reaches the cathode, you close the circuit and you actually generate photocurrent. There are many problems and opportunities in improving the organic photovoltaic solar cells, and they have been tackled in the sense that there are a few experimental solar cells that already make beyond 10% efficiency. And of course, we want to increase the formation of these excitations, make them diffuse as far as possible, have near perfect charge separation, very efficient charge transport, and then don't get trapped in the interface with the electrode. And many research groups around the world, both theory and experimentally, have been concentrating on many of these aspects. My group has been concentrating on exciton and charge transport, and a little bit on exciton formation. Okay, so I will be discussing some of these aspects as we go along. So this is a video that one of my undergraduate students made about how an organic solar cell works. We're entering this microscopic layer, and what we're seeing here is kind of the artistic representation of an electron hole pair, or an exciton, moving through a polymer. Okay, and again, this is just an artistic representation. And finally, this reaches an interface. For example, in this particular case, the donor has the exciton. And as we dramatically rotate around the fullerene, we're going to see the electron being transferred to the fullerene, which is a very good electron acceptor, which has a very low reionization energy. And the hole diffused back through the interface, all the way down to the interface. And this is a quite an interesting theoretical problem, because as you can see from this movie and in general, you have a big morphology question, right? How are these guys blended together in between the transparent indium tin oxide electrode and the reflective aluminum electrode? Is a lot of the story, right? How the experimentalists blended these materials so they work correctly. Nevertheless, there's a lot of theory in, for example, what are the right materials and how will they work, right? So really, a multi-scale mindset is what one needs to have. And in our project, we actually tackle a few parts of the puzzle. Okay? So let's just begin by what are the critical parameters that one would like to model using the computer to try to predict new materials. Ideally, would you like to go to actually predicting parameters related to the efficiency of the solar cell? What we see here on the left is a typical solar cell efficiency curve. Okay? So what we see here is, for example, this VOC is voltage at zero current, this parameter here. And then this JSC, or short circuit current, is a current at zero voltage. And an ideal cell will actually have a square behavior here. Most, if not all, solar cells have this curved behavior here that's more typical of all devices. And the area under this square is called the field factor. And it's kind of like the measure of how well the cell was made, because the crappier the solar cell, the smaller is that area. Okay? And ultimately, as you will see here in this formula, it impacts the power conversion efficiency of the solar cells. So it is proportional to the field factor times the area of the square, right? The area of this dotted square over here, the short circuit current times the open circuit voltage divided by the incoming power. Okay? So this is a very simple formula that tells you what would be the efficiency of a solar cell. And of course, what we like to do is to try to correlate theoretical parameters of molecules calculated with Q-Chem software all the way up to the efficiency of the solar cell. So now, what are we really targeting, actually, as a first application of what we're trying to do, is what would be the molecule that has the right molecular energy levels. And many in this audience probably are familiar with this idea of the LUMO, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, and the HOMO, the highest occupied molecular orbital. And we have the HOMO of oxygen as an important parameter, because we don't want our molecule to be oxidized. We don't want our molecule or polymer to be oxidized by air. We want our plastic to be resistant to air. And we also have an acceptor, usually is fullerene-like molecule, PCBM, that has a LUMO level at minus 4.3 electron volts. And that basically pins down the ideal donor HOMO and LUMO energy levels for the molecules that we like to consider. We want to have a LUMO that is about 0.3 electron volts higher than the acceptor so that the electron transfer process can happen. You need about 0.3 electron volts to be able to break the exciton and beat entropy, you know, basically beat the free energy barrier of breaking the exciton. And again, you want your HOMO level to be as deep as possible to be able to be non-reactive with oxygen, definitely lower than the HOMO of oxygen at least. And that actually pins down what would be the ideal single junction organic solar cell. So we're going to be plotting right now this as a function of the gap, which is, you know, the same type of information. We're going to be plotting the LUMO level and the gap. And of course, from that, you can figure out what is the HOMO. And there's this very famous paper, which of course has had many improvements upon, but it's still one of the classic papers in the organic solar cell literature, that shows you the efficiency of solar cells based on a model as a function of the band gap and the LUMO level. Okay. And we see this 10% or so solar power conversion efficiency region that I like to think about it as a green target. We want to actually have our materials give us that particular Lumo level of minus 4 and a band gap of about, say, 1.6 electron volts or so to reach the maximum possible power conversion efficiency. So that's where we are right now in this diagram. We want to get there. And the question is how to do it. So this is an example of another type of molecules, molecules for whole transport. And I cannot ask my audience directly, but if I were to ask you what is a good molecule for whole transport, you might be like, well, I don't know. I mean, maybe one of you guys will say, well, maybe this is a good molecule for whole transport, or maybe this is a good molecule for whole transport. But you might not have guessed that perhaps the best one is this one, for example. Right? And this is a molecule that my group predicted. If I have time at the end, I'll be telling you about it. But the point is, it's very hard from just looking at a molecule like an organic chemist to figure out if the molecule is going to be a good molecule or a bad molecule for organic activity. Okay? So that's the question that we want to answer. So option number one is you call your experimental friend, and they will take about a year between the synthesis and purification and characterization of the molecule, right? So that's what you would like to do if you wanted to do things traditionally. Second option is to be like some of our colleagues around the world. What they do is they publish a bunch of Jack's papers and things like that by actually taking one molecule at a time that the experimental colleagues tell you. And then, for example, if the people like Schule, Johannes or Roberto took a single molecule at a time and simulated it, maybe it will take them a week or so because they are doing it serially, and they will write a paper and then get a nice publication. But I argue that doing that probably was not going to change the planet, because what we want to do is get many, 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 many molecules, as many as possible, screened as fast as possible. Right? So my group usually, of course, doesn't do this, but sometimes we actually compute molecules one at a time and try to understand them, as every other group does. Okay, and by the way, here are Schule, Johannes, and Roberto are crucial team members, and some of the other team members are actually listed over there. So this leads me to option number three. Why don't we try to learn from the people that search for extraterrestrial intelligence? Okay, and from that, what I mean is there was a very beautiful project that is still going on called the SETI at Home, where it was the first project that actually use this idea of using volunteer donors of computer time around the world help you for a noble cause. And the noble cause in this case is actually trying to find aliens. So the SETI at Home project has convinced tens of thousands of volunteers around the world to Fourier transform the sky in search of alien intelligence. And what they get in exchange is a beautiful screensaver that actually shows the Fourier transform as it's happening. Right. So it's actually a good use of your CPU time rather than just showing pictures of your cat, right? So that was actually one of the first projects. Now there are tens of projects. For example, folding at home is a very famous one for protein folding. And when I was an assistant professor, I decided that it was a good idea to actually use this type of free computer time that people otherwise throw away to actually do quantum chemistry. And this is where Q-Chem enters, and this is where Stanford enters, this is where IBM enters, and this is where this huge initiative called the Clean Energy Project got started. So I'm going to show you the pictures of the different team members, and actually let's see if you can guess them as we go along. This is the Harvard team. I really want to highlight, in particular, Johannes Hachmann here, which is in the job market. So hopefully somebody soon will hire him as a professor somewhere. I'm going to even highlight his name. This guy rocks. And he's being one of the big key players, but all of these people have done tons of work. Okay. You know this is a Harvard team because we have these cool hipster glasses. This is Aidan here, okay? So it's Averse, and we have here all our team members that have contributed to the Clean Energy Project. Here's the Stanford team. These are our experimental colleagues that actually keep us honest, right? And you know they're experimental because you can see Rajiv here with his glasses here, okay? So here's the team at Stanford that has been helping us. And the heroic team of Q-Chem, I want to say that actually our Q-Chem teams actually has the face of programmers. You can actually see this is how a programmer looks, a real hacker. And they have been, of course, helping us with porting Q-Chem to this interesting grid environment. So they've been helping us with our IBM colleagues, which are actually shown here in a tie here, okay, that actually have been helping us run the clean energy project on the grid. And the people that are not pictured, but there are hundreds of thousands of them, are the volunteers that actually download the Clean Energy Project. And those are the people that we really want to thank publicly here. Many of them will actually watch this on the YouTube, or maybe some of them are connected right now, because these are the people that actually make these computations happen. There are volunteers around the world that decide to connect their computers and make the science happen. And these are the people that are, make this project worthy. And, you know, those are the people that are awesome by helping us. So we made this video to promote the Clean Energy Project, right? This idea that we're going to actually screen a molecule in each one of these person's computers about of the order of every 12 hours. So here are actually some molecules really from our project. And in mind, the idea is that now you're trying to find a needle in a haystack. What's the best molecule for solving the problem? And for that, you throw this army of computers from different volunteers around the world, that maybe one, like this one, or maybe this other one, or maybe this other one, or this other one, might be the solution to the solar cell problem. And of course, maybe somebody around the world will actually go ahead and find that this is the right molecule, right? And, you know, the way to think about it, I mean, the way to actually do it, and Emil was asking me before the talk, is to actually go to the website, I'll give it at the end of the talk, click down on the Help Us, and in about 5 minutes, your computer is already helping us, right? So that's pretty awesome. So you can actually go there, click on download and Help Us, and actually, you know, whenever your computer is idle, it will be donating its spare cycles. So why would you do this? I mean, that's a question.
I just want to say one word to you. Just one word.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening?
Yes, sir, yeah.
Plastics.
Exactly, how do you know?
It's a great future in plastics. Think about it. What do you think about it?
Yes, I will.
I've said, that's a deal.
So there is a great future in plastics, guys. Okay, so the idea is to have plastic solar cells covering everything, right? So now, this project, of course, has a lot of infrastructure. It's probably one of the most complex things, if not the most complex thing I've done in my career, because it requires a lot, and actually not me, actually the group members, okay? Because it requires a lot of different pieces to work, right? For example, this is how the screensaver looks like. It has the logo of Harvard, the logo of Q-Chem, the logo of IBM, the logo of the World Community Grid. What you see there for those Q-Chem nerds, that's the FOC matrix as it's being diagonalized for each one of our molecules. And roughly, you might be wondering how much computer time we get from these awesome volunteer donors of computer time. Well, this is equivalent of roughly 6,500 cores per computer, right? They allow us to screen about 30,000 compounds per day. And this amounts, just for you computer nerds, to send about every 2 to 3 seconds a 7-hour calculation input file that consists of about 12 Q-Chem calculations chained together, okay? So we have to actually generate with our computers that amount of input files. We have surpassed about 14,500 years of computation. This is probably the largest single use of the Q-Chem code that we know of. And it actually is about, if you were to start a computer back when there were mammoths around the Earth, okay, and there was the Ice Age, roughly, okay, that's more or less where the amount of computer time that we have used, right? If a single computer was computing since that amount of time. And this is in about 2 or 3 years of really running this phase of the Clean Energy Project, so-called phase two, that employs Q-Chem. So to keep us honest, of course, you really need to work with experimentalists. You need to close the loop between theory, synthesis, and characterization, and we really mean it. We work with Shannon Bao and Michael Toney at Stanford, and the details of how we do it are in this cover article of the Journal of Physical Chemistry Letters of last year. So you can actually go to this article to learn about what our project is doing. And our project, unlike those groups that actually publish many JAX papers, is very careful about what we publish, and we're going to publish very soon a series of papers with all our results. So this first paper tells you our preliminary results. I'll be showing you some of them right now. But the reason is because every year we're going to be publishing our top results, as I'll show you later. Okay? So this is kind of like an approach of publishing one paper a year with our best results and keep going. Okay? This is a project that is going to take many years. So Johannes Hachmann, which is from Germany, is a very organized guy, and he came up with this bird's eye view of the project. Okay, this is a German slide, so to speak. We have 26 fragments that we combinatorially combine into about 10 million molecules. Then we have many layers of characterization. We use semi-empirics. I'm going to give you some overview of semi-empirics, but it will be short in the interest of time. You can read a couple of papers of us on that subject. Of descriptors, molecular descriptors, like pharmaceutical descriptors. We are currently collaborating with groups doing semi-empirics. But mostly, most of today, of course, I'll tell you the awesome things we'll be doing using the Q-Chem code. Then after that, and the people that have worked on this, Carlos, Aida, and Johannes, okay? We use the cyber infrastructure that I just described. The cyber infrastructure can be mostly the screensaver provided by IBM and the awesome World Community Grid, but also supercomputers like the NSF TeraGrid. We use a certain amount of molecules that do not fit on the screensaver. We actually run them on the TeraGrid. And right now, a lot of our focus is on this database where all the results are actually available and will be made available to the public very soon. And the data mining analysis and calibration, how to take the quantum chemistry data, combine it with experiment, and provide useful results for experimentalists. This is where a lot of our eggs are right now. And that's why we are about to publish this year, the main top 25,000 molecules. Of course, there's a lot of connections between this because we can actually now do quality ratings, prioritize our search, right? Do chemoinformatics, learn structure property relationships, mutate, derivate, and go back and modify the library. And we have actually completed in a test project prototypes that actually the Shen and Bao group actually has synthesized. Okay, so we go back and fully integrate into the Bao group, and that's kind of like our main big picture. For those of you that are hackers, everything here is Python. We're Pythonistas. We love Python. Okay, so the things that are completely finished are in green. The things that are under constant development are in green and yellow, and the things that we need to continue working on are the things that are in pure yellow. Okay, so now I'm going to give you a very brief overview of our molecule generation and chemoinformatics. I will show you then our quantum chemistry results, and then I probably will skip the theory and experiment validation of high mobility materials, but I might show you some highlights, depending on how we're doing on time. So molecule generation is quite cool, right? I mean, we want to generate polymers that look like this one. This is an example of a high-efficiency polymer, okay? They have donor and acceptor motifs that contain a lot of heteroatoms, like the ones I'm highlighting here, right? They are conjugated, flexible. And for doing that, we actually use tools from pharma. We use something called SMILES. We have two-dimensional representations of the molecules. I like to actually joke that this is the best way to cheat in organic chemistry exams, because you can actually text message your friend the structure of a molecule just by sending them this text thing, okay? So C1, C1 actually will correspond to this ring over here. This hyphen corresponds to this link. And I know you are a bunch of nerds. You probably figure out how to do SMILES already from these examples, okay? So we have rules to actually write our fragments in SMILES, and then there's a program specification called SMARTS, also from pharma, that allows you to, for example, create computational chemical reactions, okay? So we actually, for example, create these virtual magnesium atoms that are just there for knowing where we're going to actually fuse or link our rings. In this particular case, we link these two rings combinatorially to come up with this fragment. But we'll fuse our rings to come up with fragments like this one, right? Like, for example, I'm going to use the pen. Fragments like this one, right? So that's the kind of thing that we're actually trying to do. So Roberto was one of the people that did a lot of SMILES and smart hacking. And this is one of the libraries that eventually we'll also release to the public for people to do this combinatorial library generation. There are also commercial tools like Schrodinger Material Studio has, and I'm not working for them, but they have a commercial tool that does the same. And we have used it in my group. Actually, it's quite cool as well. Not for this project, but it's actually a cool tool as well. Shenan Bao, our experimental collaborator, was the one that drew the 26 fragments that we use for our library. Here they are. They encompass most of the high-performance molecules, but also have some, experimental patterns that she was interested on. And this is basically all the magnesium atoms tells you what are all the places where we can actually fuse or link our rings. And they're, of course, meant to be places where experimentalists can actually do something. So it's an idea of the type of molecules that we're exploring. Then, of course, we use other tools like Corina, which, by the way, was also graciously donated by Christoph Schwab from the company, Corina, to actually come up with three-dimensional structures. And all of those Q-Chem fanaticos can, of course, see that if we have these, we can actually start creating Q-Chem input files, right? This is the XYZ of the molecule generated by using force fields and minimization. We use about 5 conformers, okay? Gives you an idea of how we generate the molecules. And now, I'm not going to really spend too much time on machine learning, almost none of it, but I want to tell you the tools that we use to actually get quickly predictions based on just these three-dimensional structures of the molecules and two-dimensional structures of which will be good or bad organic solar cells. And for doing that, what we actually do is we use tools from machine learning. So imagine you want to predict the face of this ugly man. And for that, you have something called weak classifiers. Okay, there will be, say, other features or images that actually might or might not resemble this guy. And by themselves, we might be very bad classifiers for this guy. But you can actually linearly combine them and come up with a strong classifier that will be able to recognize this ugly man. Your camera, every time it's recognizing a face, or Facebook when it's recognizing a face, or Google Images, use this type of machine learning approaches to use weak classifiers to actually build strong classifiers and in turn build models that will tell you, for example, how to recognize this ugly man. We do the same. We actually train sets with experimental data sets that actually my colleagues in my group help collect. We have a database, probably one of the largest databases, if not the largest database of experimental numbers out there for organic solar cells, that we use for training our quantum chemistry. Our quantum chemistry is useless by itself, usually. We actually need to calibrate to experimental data. And then apply different machine learning strategies, like, for example, binary classification and Gaussian processes and so on. And then we employ it on increasingly growing models. So this is what we have published so far in orange. And the type of things we're doing right now are in blue. And of course, we want to continue improving our machine learning and, of course, being better predictive models. And this is why I've been saying to you guys that what we want to do is actually keep doing this and publish every year as we go along. So, for example, if you have about 90 original molecular descriptors, like the ones I'm showing you there, you can actually use binary classification saying, okay, will each one of these guys will be a useful descriptor by itself for organic photovoltaic activity, a yes-no vote of confidence on each one of the descriptors, and that can reduce you to a model of about 19 descriptors, some of them coming from quantum chemistry, for example, the HOMO level, or the non-Lewis orbital character of NBO. By the way, these two come from Q-Chem, okay? And other ones that come from cheminformatics, like the steric hindrance, or the number of heteroatoms. These turn out to be important descriptors for organic photovoltaic activity. From that, you build models, and these are overfitted linear models. Those are the first ones we published. Now we know they are overfitted. We'll give you an idea that of the things that we want to do. We want to get correlations between our predicted values, okay, this predicted open circuit voltage or predicted power conversion efficiency with experimental power conversion efficiency, okay? So again, what went in here is like a mixture of quantum chemistry data, experimental data for training the model, and then some descriptors for the molecules to try to come up with some sort of predictive ability of what is a good organic photovoltaic or not. This is an example of a descriptor that comes from cheminformatics, the energy to break an aromatic bond from Huckel theory, that is actually quite useful for photovoltaic. And from that, we get some of the results. I'm not going to dwell a lot on them. But some training set results, this green line over, these green data points over here are from the training set. And this distribution here is what about 3 million molecules look like. And from that, we can actually go and look what are the things that we believe on, what are the things that are not reliable. For example, we don't believe we can actually think about predicting the field factor, which is an experimental component. We can actually try to filter our molecules by the product of the predicted voltage and current, the area of the ideal square that I was mentioning before. So if we actually try to filter our molecules like that, what is really, really encouraging is that our islands of predicted voltage and current here and here will actually be very good, right? This is the voltage, sorry, the current and the voltage. And if we actually pick from our molecules that have the largest currents, you actually see molecules that our experimental colleagues would like to say look like conductors. They have alternating organic moieties, very rotatable, and they look like good conductors, say, for example, polytiophene. The ones that have high voltages open up the gap by actually having a lot of aromaticity, and they look like these beasts over here. So what's really encouraging is that our machine learning actually looks like the things that experimental colleagues think are good materials. And actually, a lot of the lessons that people learn from organic materials are shown in our training, the molecules that we actually scan for the highest product of voltage and current, which combine donor-acceptor motifs, patterns that actually open up the gap, and patterns that have high mobility. Okay, so this is the type one of the molecules that, for example, could be pulled off from our machine learning strategies. Okay, so I'm going to move on for the remainder of the talk to what we do with Q-Chem. Okay, what are the quantum chemistry data that we actually use in the grid, and we actually run the largest quantum chemistry experiment that we know to date using the awesome Q-Chem software. That will be the end of the talk. So maybe this is for those Q-Chem aficionados, the type of model chemistries that we run. So far, we are running only ground state quantum chemistry calculations. We run a geometry optimization at a particular level of theory, density functional theory. And then we proceed to run different levels of theory, Hartree Fock and flavors of DFT, increasing the level of exact exchange, okay, using one as a guess for the other. Okay, so we keep moving. And you use two basis sets and two spin multiplicities. And then we ask Q-Chem to give us as many as possible of all the properties of these molecules, right? So this roughly is about 16 different Q-Chem calculations, or 12, I don't remember exactly the number, on a particular molecule, including a geometry optimization. And all of that data is actually returned to us. Some of the technicalia, we have about 100K input file that is sent to our users run it. We get about a 20 to 100 megabyte output file that comes to our database. And it's collected by IBM, sent to us, and we have about 600 terabytes of disk space, about 400 terabytes or so of data already. Okay, so we have tons of data that came out from the users stored. So how, this is even an example of a sample that we did, 4.5 million conformers. This data is about a 1 year old. Right now we are, of course, more in the order of 23 million conformers. Okay, so just get an imagination that you can make this plot way more molecules. And this corresponds to 65 million DFT calculations. I will be showing you now, right now we have 145 million DFT calculations done by Q-Chem. Okay? And this is a histogram of those 4.5 million molecules, the number of molecules as a function of the number of heavy atoms and as a function of the number of electrons. Just to give you an idea of the size of the molecules we're running with Q-Chem every day out there. This is as a function of the date of where we started the project. Again, we've been doing this for about 2 years in the grid. The number of results that we've been getting, and this fluctuates because there are different projects launched, different projects going and going, coming and going. Users turn off their computers because it's hot and so on. And this gives you an idea of the number of results we get a day, about 25,000 molecules, 25,000 12-hour calculations every day from different people around the planet. Now, as I was telling you before, quantum chemistry by itself doesn't really tell you too much. This is the histogram of the HOMO levels of different levels of theory. You can see over there our different DFTs and the different geometry optimization levels. And you see how all the different HOMOs are going all over the place. Okay? This is all of them together. When you actually calibrate with experimental data, and this is an early calibration with only 60 data points, now we have about 1,000 experimental data points, all the islands collapse. This is very promising, right? All the HOMOs, when you calibrate with experiment, look almost equally the same. You can, of course, do the same for the LUMOs, although it's a little bit more tricky. I'm going to skip that. And that will give you the gaps. So here is actually, again, just to tell you, this is a plot that actually has ab initio results for about 1.5 million molecules. For me, that's actually amazing, right? Because really you're seeing the actual, how can you say, the working space of organic photovoltaics according to our library, right? You can have gaps close to zero, which are organic conductors, all the way up to 6 electron volts, right? And you see more or less what is the distribution of these gaps. You can, of course, imagine plotting HOMO versus LUMO, and that's what I like to call the dynamic gap range. But if you plot it with points, it's so dense that it looks very, very crappy. So you want to go to a plot that looks like so, all right? Each one of these points now contains tens of thousands of molecules. So to see this better, we're going to use a log plot. So this is the log of the number of molecules. And you actually now see the dynamic gap range of HOMO versus LUMO for the molecules that we have computed. Okay, this is aggregation of about 4.5 million molecules. And in turn, we have different plots for each one of these levels of theory, as I'll show you in the next slide. Here we have on the left the uncalibrated HOMO, the gap versus LUMO, the so-called Charter plot I was showing you earlier, as it goes along for different theory levels, and the calibrated with experiment island. So what is very promising is that you see that the islands on the left are all moving all over the place for different theory levels, but the calibrated ones actually are quite constant, and that is the value of experiments. And those are the islands, right, that we call tunnels of computer time, are allowing us to do the type of prediction that we'll publish this year, okay, or we submit to for publication this year, okay, of looking again at this band gap versus LUMO plot here, and try to go to this region over here of high efficiency, right, over here. I'm going to plot it here from one of our models. This is the BP86 SVP at the PBC.TCVP geometry, okay, or perhaps vice versa, actually, perhaps vice versa. So we optimize the geometry here and calculate the energy here, sorry. And here is the actual about 10% efficiency region, okay, well, around there. And that's about 25,000 or so molecules. And you can actually see that different levels of theory more or less give us the same island. What is remarkable, right, and I really like to emphasize, is that if you really think about it, most of the experimental molecules are around 5 or 6% efficient over here, which makes sense. That means our organic colleagues is more or less randomly sampling this island, the island of the maximum number of molecules, right? You need a theory to actually try to guide you to the area where there are less and less molecules, right? And theory take you to this area. Try to come up with patterns that actually help our experimental colleagues produce more molecules that are 10% efficient. Okay, so that's where we are trying to head right now. Again, this is about 25,000 molecules now. For those of you Q-Chem aficionados, what we're after now is actually running on the grid and also on the supercomputer. This type of property, that all of them, advertising Q-Chem here, can be calculated with the beautiful, awesome Q-Chem code. Some of them not, I guess, right, the CASIS perhaps. We need to run another code. Code things that are similar to that. And then here we have some of the predictive oligomers. It's a very old, very, very old prediction. Actually, these probably are not some of the top now, but these are some of the predictive oligomers that came out from fully quantum chemistry. Okay, so this is what hopefully we help our colleagues, experimental colleagues, dream up new molecules. And you have to think about it as pharma. We're going to be predicting some patterns, and the experimental colleagues might synthesize them, and they might or may not work. Okay. Now, what we're also going to release is this CEP database. All this data was generated by the public and will be released to the public. Okay, there's going to be search fields, scoring and ranking and data mining tools that right now you're seeing our ghetto/development version of them. But you can imagine how to search this database using this type of parameters. Okay, we're also collaborating with other partners, many partners, including Steven Wolfram and Wolfram Alpha, for releasing this with Wolfram Alpha. We have sent our data to other people, such as Kitware, and we're starting to talk to people in Chemaxon to actually give them our data and have them actually also release the data in their own forms. Okay, we want this data to be available, so there it's in the web in many different places. But of course, our CEPDB will try to be our own centrally controlled repository that we can actually add features to, and it will be again free to the public. The tools that you can actually harvest from pharma are amazing. This is Dotmatics Vortex, a product from pharma that allows people in that industry to actually catalog materials. In this particular case, usually, of course, they are pharmaceutical molecules. But here we use the same tool with a rotating student over the summer to actually scan a very small fraction of our database for gap, for example, gap versus, this is gap versus power conversion efficiency. Power compression efficiency on the y-axis, right, and generate sharper plots on the fly, right. So this is more or less the type of interactivity that we strive for, okay. Searching again, this is results that came from quantum chemistry, right. What are the best molecules to use for solar cells, right? So this just gives you an idea of how I see the future of quantum chemistry, not doing one molecule at a time, but hundreds of thousands of molecules at a time. That should be, I will argue, and maybe I will open for questions with that too, the type of workflow that we should actually be thinking about for the future of quantum chemistry, I would say. Let me just finish this video. Okay, but it gives you an idea when you hover on a molecule, you can actually see which molecule it is, and be in the list of the molecules you like, print it, etc. I'm going to skip our collaboration with Experiment because I want to leave ample time for questions. Okay, so this is the annoying part where the speaker actually skips some slides. So bear with me, okay? And I'm just going to end by showing you this very important slide of a crystal, the one I skipped the story about, a crystal that we predicted and was synthesized at Stanford, and is the second best whole mobility material. This was not done with spin saver, but with similar tools, okay? So this is a material that was done using the computer and eventually became a device, the device that you see here. So that's a proof of concept, this thing works. Here are the papers for those scientific aficionados that want to look at them. And very importantly, you can connect here to the cleanenergyharvard.edu and download this project. And if the 22 people that are still here, the 6 that are gone, I have the statistics of how many people are still in the room. When I look at it, please download it, and it would be amazing to have 22 new users, right? It would be awesome. And we are there in the forums every day answering questions. We have a Facebook page. This is a social environment. We really want to be in contact with the people that actually run the calculations. And again, this is one of the most amazing parts of the project, the fact that we deal with humans and they actually participate in the scientific discovery. And with that, I want to thank my group. This is my current and former group members. I listed all over the place the people that contributed to the Clean Energy Project, right? But I'm going to show you a picture of them. Here they are. And also a picture of the Clean Energy Project team. My slides are messed up. A picture of the Clean Energy Project team that I show you, which is cute. And then I will open for questions. If I can find it soon. Sorry, that was a mess up on my part. Here they are. So here is the Clean Energy Project team as it stood a couple years ago. And I am made in Mexico, I come from Mexico. And with that, I want to open up for questions from the forum and also from the Q-Chem guys. Thank you for your attention. I know attending an internet seminar is not as cool as seeing the people in person. So thank you for hanging out.
Thank you very much, Alan. On behalf of all the audience today, I would like to thank you for this inspiring lecture. And of course, the project is very important, not only scientifically, but humanly. Now, I'm going to see if there were some questions posed in advance. Otherwise, I'll give, let's say, something like half a minute to people to organize their thoughts and start asking some questions.
Maybe they're all downloading the screensaver right now.
Who?
No, just joking. It's just me. I'm just making a joke.
Maybe they're downloading the screensaver. I see. So people, don't be shy. Anything that you might be interested in, you know,
well, I see a question there by John Keller. Does each client computer carry out calculations on one molecule? I want to answer that question, John.
Oh, okay. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
So, John, each molecule, each computer is downloading a molecule every 12 hours or so. Downloads a molecule from the server, runs it, sends about 20 to 100 megabytes of data back to the server, downloads another 100 KB input file for the next molecule, and keeps doing that. So that's why I'm saying that roughly we do, we're screening about 6,000 or so molecules simultaneously. That translates into about 30,000 molecules a day. I hope that answers the question of John. And actually, John is asking another one. So each computer runs Q-Chem? Yes, John. Each computer runs Q-Chem, John. It's a version of Q-Chem that can only run with a screensaver, of course. You cannot use it to run your own calculations. If you want to run your own calculations, you should download the demo from Q-Chem and run the official Q-Chem version.
There's a question now from Marco Masia, who is asking the following. How capable are you of guessing the condensed phase properties of the materials from gas phase calculations?
Marco, this is a very important question. Of course, we cannot guess all the condensed phase properties, if any, right, from quantum chemistry calculations. But this is the surprising thing. Some of the condensed phase properties can be deduced from the just from the chemoinformatics. Turns out that if you want to correlate current, which current is a very condensed phase property, with a chemoinformatics model, you can actually see that descriptors that matter, for example, are the number of rotatable bonds. And you actually tell people, hey, dude, would you think the number of rotatable bonds is important for transport? And they will tell you, yes, it's very important because transport has to have fluctuations in the polymer backbone. So it turns out that some of the condensed phase parameters can be deduced with cheminformatics and the molecular structure. Okay, so kind of the same way an organic chemist will look at it and guess if it's good or bad, machine learning can also do that. But Marco, we don't run condensed phase simulations ourselves, so definitely we would like to collaborate in the future or provide our data to people that do such a thing. I hope that answers the question of Marco. If not, please type it again, or, you know.
Yes, also to the whole audience, whoever wants to have a follow-up question, please type it again. That is because if you allow you guys to speak, there will be, again, interference in the voice. So I, as a moderator, am supposed to deliver in reading the questions you might have. So, Edward, go ahead and type your question if you have some, even if it's a follow-up. John Keller is asking again, what operation system and hardware requirements on clients? That's something that I also was asking before, if you remember.
Okay, first, yes, and also Parta has a question I see over there. Let me just answer that one, and then maybe I'll take Parta's too.
Okay.
You were asking that. You guys can see right now my computer, right? I hope you can see my computer.
You have to share it again, Alan.
This is show my screen. Okay, great. You guys see this?
Yes. Now it's okay.
So this is my browser. Okay, I'm showing you the World Community Grid website. This is the website of our partners at IBM, which are the most awesome partners ever, also. And here you see the requirements for the clean energy project. About a gigabyte of RAM dedicated to the project, 2 gigs of disk space, Windows, Mac, or Linux. And, you know, this is about typical data transfer size for our work units. You can see that we are kind of like the big enchilada of all the projects, because you have to download a copy of Q-Chem of about 200 megabytes. You download input files that are quite small, but you have to send us the largest amount of data of any project. So we're very proud to say that our project is one of the big enchiladas. I hope that answers the question. So should I answer, Partha?
Go ahead.
How do you account for errors in backcast computation using DFT? You calibrate against high accuracy calculations? Partha, I calibrate against experiment. I believe that experiment is a very good thing to calibrate. I hope that the plot I showed you where all the islands collapsed to one curve convinced you that calibrating against experiment is a good idea. We, of course, could also calibrate against high quality calculations. We haven't done so. And this is related to Jihan's question. I use several functionals for my study. Which one do I recommend? Jihan, I'm going to withhold that because all my calibrated functionals are about equally. So I would not recommend a particular functional. Okay.
Edward is asking a question. So the question of Edward is, I work in the area of crystal structure prediction of molecular crystals. Could you apply this to the problem of the condensed phase? And how do you plan to predict it?
Keep going. Sorry, he said something else?
Yes. Yes. How do you plan on predicting molecular packing in order to calculate transfer integrals in your screening process?
Edward, that's the part I skipped. Okay, let me show you. I'm going to go back to PowerPoint. I think it's still showing my screen, right? So we work on that, Edward. Here is, for example, a predicted crystal structure. This Da22 molecule, we predicted its crystal structure. This is a very expert section. So here is our simulated crystal structure and our real crystal structure. We're very lucky that we did this because we use just Accelerase. Okay, where probably you have better software than we have. But we use Accelerase, and this particular case, for that particular test case, it worked pretty well. So we usually do it for molecules that we really care about. And turns out that molecule, according to Samsung, is the world's best molecule for organic electronics. According to Samsung, this is a slide from Samsung. Okay? But I'll refer you to our Nature Communications paper. In this other paper here is a Nature paper with Shenan Bao. We also looked at the displacement of these tips pentosine molecules. And I'll show you just the calculation of, for example, the transfer integral as a function of displacement. So I guess this type of research is closer to the one that you do. So if you have any questions, feel free to email me or call me. I'm very happy to talk to you offline about details of the transfer integrals. We do some of that work as well in my group. I hope that answers your question. Feel free to type more about it and so on. I just don't want to bore the entire audience with that. So we do that case by case. We don't do it on the screensaver. If you have any ideas about how to do it on the screensaver or you have called Edward, happy to talk to you, of course.
That was interesting. Alan, there is a technical question that I'm interested in too. The question is posed by Quadir. And it is, how do you deal with failed calculations in the sense of SCF does not converge? Is there any manual review of the results that you receive, or it's an automatic screening or something?
Kadir, we cannot review automatically, because if you really think about it, if you receive an output file every 2 to 3 seconds, sorry, but manually, you're kind of screwed, right? I mean, you cannot do it, sorry. But we can, of course, use scripts to actually find out which molecules did not converge. We have the data. It's too bad that Johannes is not here, but I don't remember the percentage of molecules that do not converge. We have not sent them back to the grid, but we plan to send them back with different convergence parameters to actually send them again. You see what I mean? So at the moment, Kadir, if a molecule did not converge, it's not in my database. But certainly we have all those molecules. So to speak, it's not in the results database, but it's in the calculation database. And we plan to publish a paper, actually, with the statistics of the molecules that did not converge and why and so on. So definitely we want to look at this issue eventually, but it's low priority. So yes, that's important news. There's a lot of important information for developers of electronic structure in this database that you will be able to look at. You will be able to look up these molecules that did not converge and figure out yourself why this happened. So yes, there's a lot of things. You could also go there and think about the performance of functionals and things like that.
I probably will finish, if you don't mind, Alan, with something that is not a question, but Gene Diamond is saying something like that. I don't have questions, but I loved your talk. Lots of useful information. Thank you for a great presentation. And basically, I also would like to join this same opinion. Thank you, Alan, for this great presentation. We're looking forward to new results in the near future.
Yes, and I'm going to say something. I mean, I'm seeing more questions by Marco and John.
Go ahead.
I'm not going to answer them. I'm just going to tell them, send me emails.
Go ahead.
No, I'm just going to tell them there are questions about metals and so on. We have not considered molecules with metals. I think both of them ask the same question. Okay? We have not worked on that yet. But in any case, I'm going to open, because this is going to be in YouTube, for people to send us email. People can go to the forums in the Clean Energy Project. We have some forums run by IBM. Okay? Again, thank IBM and thank the users. Thank my group. But in general, you know, feel free to keep contacting us. This is a two-way street. And I really also want to say that the Q-Chem guys have been amazing helping us debug everything. And allowing us for the first place to put a commercial package on tens of thousands of computers of people around the world. So I really want to thank everybody. That's what I want to say, because this project is not just me, it's tons of people.
This concludes our webinar. We would like to thank Professor Aspuru-Guzik for his awesome presentation. If you've not tried Q-Chem lately, we have come a long way, and we invite you to utilize our 2-month full-featured demo which you can request by hitting the orange free demo button on our website. Should you have any questions, please feel free to contact us by emailing either Jinting or Yihan at the email addresses noted on your screen. We also invite you to visit us on Facebook. Thank you for your participation, and see you at the next webinar.